Today, I invited Blasé, a friend of mine in Poland, which I met a couple of years ago, and we share some genuine interest in having technical excellence being put in place, and especially agile organizations as such. And in today's session, we are going to explore why we both think technical excellence is a crucial aspect to make agile really work and drive impact for an organization. With no further ado, let me introduce you to Blasé. Well, actually, I will not introduce you. You introduce yourself to our audience. So, Blasé, who are you?
I'm a human being that loves to learn and grow myself, and this is who I am. I'm also a Scrum Master and a teacher on Agile and also technical excellence. So, this is who I am.
So we see in the world that there is a kind of a movement. If I look at some of the more technical oriented, development oriented conferences and community, I see lots of people these days going like, yeah, we hate Scrum, we hate Agile, most probably because they were in Agile play theater, or we implement projects by Scrum. Way of working is still the real thing, but anyhow, we see lots of technical people hating the Agile world, and then we see lots of the Agile coaches around there that don't really understand the technical part. Why do you think this kind of polarization is happening these days?
It's probably because really, really a few people that really work in an agile organization. By agile, I mean an organization that can really order the stuff from what's most important to what's less, and not do anything at once. So hundreds of projects with hundreds of project managers. So and when I worked in some organization, The more I hear about Scrum teams and Agile, the less it's actually Agile at all. So I don't blame the developers. I'm starting to hate those Agile stuff as not a property of organization. So I love how you defined Agile as a property, as a software developer would create a class. So it would be a property, not some out of the box stuff. Yeah.
So, like I mentioned somewhere in one of the conferences, agility is an attribute to an object. So you need to choose to which one you want to put it on. True. And then again, you're one of those rare species around that is still very interested in Agile as such, and in Scrum and Agile practices from an organizational people perspective, but also into more of the technical excellence perspective. Why is that?
If I see us as a group, one thing is in common: we started as software developers, and also we love to make our hands dirty with that stuff that we don't understand. So this is, I guess, why. But also, it's an important stuff of really Agile organization. So since Agile Manifesto, they state that continuous attention to technical excellence and good design enhances agility. So technical excellence was important right from the beginning.
So I love that you quote one of the 12 principles from the Agile Manifesto. And so great, great stuff. If we look at technical excellence, what is in your perception then technical excellence? Where does it start? Where does it stop?
Yeah, I actually had to Google what technical excellence means. So just to share with others surprised like me, technical excellence is the ability to foresee and eliminate an issue before it has the potential to jeopardize safety, schedule, budget, quality, but most important, client satisfaction. So even I was surprised it's even not about quality, but overall client satisfaction. Like one in a new post, you said the client will forgive that something is out of schedule, but won't forget and forgive that something is bad in quality. Like, for example, in our Polish company, the famous cyberpunk game that was released too early. Okay.
So you were quoting one of the things that I put on LinkedIn. So no user remembers that you delivered late, but they will all remember you delivered crap, which is a quote from Jurgen Aplo, by the way. Then again, you see that people somehow agree or find it intriguing, and which I find strange as well, by the way. But anyhow, if I look at this LinkedIn post, it's one of the more successful posts I had. It's been there out there for a couple of days now, and it has more than 3,000 views already. So which for me is really strange again. We see many of the people, Agile, Scrum Masters, all of that, and it's all about process, organizational structures, and the humpy dumpy, keep people happy, fluffy duffy approach. And if I then ask people that come to my last trainings, for example, or in conferences or other meetups, and I ask like, yeah, what do you know about technical excellence, about really developing, coding a product, software as such, then I'm astonished how little many of those people know about it. So even though it's in the Agile Manifesto, if we post something on LinkedIn like this, then it has high rates and all that stuff. So what was your perception? So I started as a software engineer, you started as a software engineer, so it comes a bit natural that we understand how to create code. To be honest, when I started as a software engineer, it was very ugly code. I didn't know how to code. Even though I studied computer science, I have to admit, it took me a couple of years to really understand decent code craftsmanship practices. Now, what about you?
Back to something said just a while before. So the obvious stuff about technical excellence is actually the most mind-blowing. And for example, what surprises me is, for example, many discussions in the organization are about the technical tasks. So somehow the organization divides stuff on business tasks and technical tasks, and the developers end up complaining about that they don't have time to really make a high quality product, make it right. And when I hear that, it's like, when I was a software developer, never ever had a project manager to decide if I write a high quality code or not. It was only my decision. So my motivation, I written good code, I written crap, but only if I was lazy. And actually lazy is something that describes a good developer. So how to take the laziness of the developer, but craft it somehow into technical excellence. But many developers I met are saying like that. So the product owner, the product manager won't let us to write good code. And I'm like, okay, when you order a piece pizza as a client, it's like, okay, so I can choose, for example, a pizza with my own ingredients, and nobody puts in the menu like onions, potato, tomato, and wash the dishes. And the washing dishes in a backlog is some kind of the comparison for technical elements in the backlog. So what's your opinion? Why the developers are saying we have no time for writing good quality code?
I'm very blunt to that. So if developers tell me I'm not entitled to write decent code, then most probably they don't even make it explicit. They don't make it a conscious decision. For me, that's building up reckless debt, a little like I've mentioned in past YouTube videos. It's not technical debt even. It's nothing to do. This is plain stupidity. And I really, this is like, you're the victim of your own choices. To be honest, for many of those engineers, I say, okay, my project manager or anybody else, product owner doesn't allow me, or my manager, whatever, doesn't allow me to write decent, well-crafted code or features or products as a whole, by the way. If we ask them, those same people, do you think your project manager or your manager truly understands this kind of low-level coding and lower-level architectural patterns that you apply or not apply in this case? So do you really think they can actually discover and evaluate if it's good or bad? What do you think they answer?
Yeah, they're probably frozen, yes, because something is moving in their head. So this is what I also see. So back to your second question would be when I want to learn technical excellence, yes? So good practices. It has to be fun. And I have to have space for that, but it's also my decision, like you said. So I'm many times surprised why the developers choose to write stupidity code and take on the misery on them next time. So
yeah, you know, there's always more good ideas than time to execute upon, so that there is some kind of pressure being put forward on delivering more and more. Unfortunately, in too many cases, the focus is on output instead of outcomes. But anyhow, let's not go into that subject today. If I see where pressure being put, it's normal behavior. And for me, it's about if you're a software engineer or you're part of a development team, if you know write code or not, it doesn't matter. You're part of the development team, then it's about not negotiating on technical excellence. So make sure technical excellence is always top notch. But you negotiate on the functional excellence. So even though if things are there, people go way too much in building products, like I also put in a previous YouTube video, building products instead of growing products. So and they still have this impression we need to build a product. So it's detailed, or the impression is there for all the details and all the separate pieces. And then at the end, we put it all together and it's going to work. They don't even think about. And they do this iteratively these days. So we do Scrum, but we build block one and then block two and then block three. And only at the end, we have something that is somehow functional or hopefully functional for the end user. If we do growing products, it's like we think about the skateboard, as I want to explain it. So we need to go from A to B. We think about the outcome, the problem we want to solve, and what's the absolute smallest thing we need to build a skateboard to go from A to B. And as soon as we have there, we learn from the interaction with the end users, with the customers, and then we can grow to, I don't know, a path where there's a steering wheel, and then we can go to a bicycle and so forth and so forth. But this kind of approach, and that's where I think technical excellence starts, is in having the understanding on how to grow products and don't go into traditional analysis practices. Do you agree?
My experience is exactly the same. So I see better technical excellence in organizations that are saying, let's design an experiment to make, for example, increase conversion or reduce accounts drops. So outcome based and in the language experiment. And I see poor technical excellence where we have projects, where we have fixed scope or a feature factory with huge backlogs. So I totally agree. And this is also my experience.
Connected to that, the only reason that you can do this kind of growing a product or growing features, according to my current understanding, you will need high technical excellence, because if you want to grow a feature or grow a product, then you need to have a mechanism of fast feedback. And this is why I consider it, like, if you go in agile practices, which is for me a small difference between agile and lean. Lean is, for me, we want to reduce variation, have single piece flow, and have some kind of stable process. If I look at Agile, it has a lot of similarities, except that Agile is built to absorb variation, not to try to reduce it as much as possible, but to make sure if it pops up and we have some learning or some surprise effect that we can absorb variation. So any kind of Agile thing will need to rely on fast feedback. And for me and my current experience, even as a starting software engineer, if I build crappy code, but I need to put it at the customer's hands very fast, then I get a hit in the face. The next time I will develop it differently and more appropriately. My past was also, I was employee number 12 back in 1996, by the way. I had to write code. I had to put it in the hands of the end users. I had to listen to the end users. I had to do the support calls. I had to do the full shebang. And I think today's world, too many software engineers get into a team where they are isolated from all the rest of the attributes of running a product in production. And because they are shielded from all that stuff, they develop differently.
Yeah, I agree. I love to think about technical excellence also as a competency of the people that build stuff, so software developers or product developers. And the key SA model, as a dividing it from the competency, is that a competency is knowledge. So I know something, skills, I can do something, and also attitude, that I want to do it or not. So for example, you say that the system is putting the developers in that position. I agree, but I also see developers that front-end developer says, I only do in front, and I also need a business analyst to tell me how will the system work businessly, or how the UX designer, how it will look. So even the developers don't like in your and Platon cave metaphor, they don't see opportunity to have joy of developing a product and making decision not only in their stuff, but making decision product wise, so designing experiments. And this is an attitude stuff, and I see my role to change that attitude of the developers so they want to know the problem, not only what is the solution. They want to engage in experiments, but they also want to spend time on making quality code and share their knowledge, because it's not about what the developer's current competencies is for me, but how they share it in the team. So for example, our role would be, and also the of managers, is how to make the developer's attitude to be more product focused, but also to be more, I want to learn how make a good product and not develop one component in over 12 years. So to finalize, I know developers that are developing one component in the huge system for many years. And when I ask them, okay, how do you find joy in what you do? Our goal is to make the component really good. But when I ask him, is even someone using it? He says, don't know. So what's your opinion on the attitude of the developers to also step out of their job title?
Yeah, I don't know.
Related to technical excellence, in your opinion?
Well, I love the conversation we have, because we say, okay, technical excellence, and what do I see happening? And most of the non-techies immediately bail out, and they think it's about really writing code and architecture, like I have had some conversations with Nilis, for example, on those things. But technical excellence, I love the conversation we have. It starts with the collaboration and the outcome-based thinking within the organization to move forward and grow from that sense. So this I do like. If you ask me the mentality of, and you say developers, I would say the mentality of people in enterprise organizations, then most probably, if I look at the startups and startup coaching that I did in the past, then you don't have this over there. They are more all of intrapreneurs. And I think that's a more healthy environment in that sense. Then again, in lots of the enterprise organizations, you see indeed people coming by or not experiencing what it could be to be in this kind of entrepreneurial environment. They immediately go from school into enterprise organizations, and let's be honest, what do they do in schools these days? They box you as well into a small box, and this is your education. So you don't have a broad. When I did computer science, it was the full spectrum and all that. Today, you go to school to teach, to become a front-end engineer. You go to school to be an AI engineer. You go to school to become a data engineer. And you don't, to my current experience or observations, I don't think in schools or universities these days, they teach people how to collaborate cross expertise in that sense. And to give up a bit of your own efficiency in the favor of the effectiveness of the whole. That's at least my current, observation of the environments I'm in at this moment in time. So, but you're a younger person than I am, so I'm an old guy, so you can most probably relate more to other generations than I do, because this is where I have a difficulty with the newer, younger generations. It seems to be too much boxed, and a job is a job, while for me, my job is my passion, and my job is my hobby. It's not a job, it really is my hobby. So, and this is also something I see less in the new generation of university graduates versus what I saw in my own age.
When you see from the perspective of I'm finished the high school and join us as a software developer, a junior software developer. In my history, it was like when I saw the features coming up to our team, it was like, oh, I'm stupid, I don't understand that. But actually now I know that you have to have guts and skills to really ask the question on why are we building something, and really the attitude to challenge the solution. So for example, many times I see, our goal is to rewrite it on Linux, or for example, move it to microservices or clouds. And the young guys don't challenge it. And when you become old, you just get used to it. So you lose all the fun of the entrepreneurship you mentioned before. So one of things I do with teams is to introduce mock programming sessions because many times they work alone. And many times it's because they're in component teams. So a member in a component teams don't work with they flows, but with other components using communication via Jira tickets. So when they work, it's like, can you help me? But it's not collaboration. So this is one thing I many times don't see collaboration in a team. I also try to introduce impact mapping, also a nice tool to talk about not only what we are trying to build, but why. This is other stuff that can add fun to really be a developer that introduces technical excellence, because he thinks not only about his part, but we are making an impact on the product. Let's make it right. And also what I like is it's stolen from Goiko. So not put into the backlogs the technical stuff. You want other stuff like writing emails or recruit new persons. But so why you add stuff like clear database or refactor code? So we use the sprints as something that makes us a sustainability gives us. So for example, we leave some space in the sprint for the team to develop. But still what I see is many times people choose to be a feature factory because they don't need to think about, okay, how to improve. So how do you tackle the problem of I get an old system and where to start?
Yeah, and I think this is definitely an enterprise organization. I get an old system. And I think that's where lots of the entrepreneurship mindset goes away, because they don't see how to make it more flexible to adapt or to change things so they comply to whatever is there already, because there is a huge complex misery architectural product being put in place. What I do like is that you came up with impact mapping from Hoikoba, for example. So Hoiko is a, and if people want to understand this, there is plenty of workshops Hoiko is doing around impact mapping. So go to his classes or workshops in that sense. And then he connected it to, for example, the product backlog management and saying, okay, we don't use our product backlog basically to do resource management. Because if you say clean database and that's where we see that the product backlog is being used as the new resource management tool instead of really as a tool to enable agility. So this is there. So, and then we need to bring it more into the development teams as well. And I know you're doing extreme programming workshops. You're doing BDD workshops. So how does this relate to the complete story?
So BDD is like impact mapping. It helps bring business people to the developers by conversations. It's a tool to really formulate the problem. We discussed lately, for example, example mapping session. So we got two facilitation tools. So example mapping, impact mapping, this all help to really connect the problem with the potential solutions. And what I see many times is that who even want to introduce BDD in companies? Many times testers. So there are the only guys that want to introduce that. And the power structures, the testers are, I don't want to say that I'm on the bottom line, but in many organizations we got a shift. So some people are treated better, some worse, because of the systematic approach on different roles. So what I see, tester would like to introduce that, but they all alone with themselves, and they start to look at BDD only from the Gherkin type of view. So only you define business cases, but you actually are rewriting only test cases. So we recently talked that BDD is simple, but for me it's difficult because you have to engage all the other role and really show that it's not about writing test cases. So even what I see is, we don't have automation, so we take a specialist and put it outside the team, and he just automates the stuff, and we do it with Gherkin, so it's BDD. It's not BDD at all if you don't start with the scenario or example, and you have to start with the scenario and example, having the stakeholders and product owner and developers on board, and it's attitude. You also have the skills to formulate it in a business language. So really to divide it's a skill to know what is a business goal. It's a skill to define behavioral changes. I see many people struggle with really is our business goal to rewrite this platform, or is our business goal to make a feature that will make current customers invite their friends, it's a skill, and it's a broad skill. That's why I see so many companies struggle with BDD.
Okay, so in your extreme programming workshops, how do they connect to the whole story?
it's not only about let's try out TDD, but it's let's try. So TDD, we got Chicago style and London style, and the London style is about let's start from the problem. And my workshops we start from the problem. So I give only a vision. I start a discussion from an initial impact map. When we really thinking about okay, we got a platform. How we could make to solve some of our users' problem, and let's come out with examples and not like we got those features. Let's write Gherkin code for that. And it's actually surprises many times not only the testers but the developers. Like, oof, we didn't even care about that. So that's why I think it's important to have the entrepreneurship mindset. So this is how I support my teams to really start want to engage in those conversations. And it's not about coding at all. So it's about how to formulate. You said recent a nice thing about facilitation. So the people don't see value in facilitation in structure. So how do you approach the topic of really aligning everybody on what problem are we trying to solve?
Yeah, so the general, in large-scale Scrum and last week, which is okay, multi-team refinements, where we easily have 100 people on board, talking about different options. But if you look at technical excellence, for me, it's more complicated than many people think. If you say technical excellence, people think it's about coding and coding structures and your build pipelines and how many branches you have. For me, it starts over there already. It starts there, right? But it's not the ending point. If I say technical excellence, in my opinion, it starts with growing towards trunk-based development. And you always, if I say to organizations, well, yeah, we need to move towards trunk-based development so that we get more rapid feedback. And it's about this rapid feedback and communicating through code in a business language. So the business language we have been talking about, we need to bring business, testers, developers all together and start to talk the same language. And this is not going to be the architectural JSON file language like things. It's really going to be you end user business vocabulary that you will need to use. And this is one part of it. Then again, if I say trunk-based development, then many people come like, yeah, this is impossible. It's impossible. And then I say, and then I add for now. Or you say, okay, it's impossible. It's not impossible, but just too expensive for now. And then it's like, what makes it expensive? What would make it expensive if we now immediately, from tomorrow on, would go with trunk-based development? And they get lots of things. Huh? And it's related to being scared to break things, and that's one. So if, okay, what makes you being scared to break stuff? Because there is no maintainable good automated test suite surrounding the thing. Okay, so why are we not building the test suite? How can we make it such small pieces so that we can start at least doing something in that direction? The solution is generally not there in a couple of months. And in many complex organizations, and that's why I think people bail out, because in many organizations it will take 1, 2, maybe 3 years, maybe even longer to actually get into a state where it's being a joy to be part of and develop into a product again. And because it's not a joy, people look for other more transaction points, more security. If you don't build in security in the automated way and the technical part on the bottom line, that's then you can do whatever you want on the organizational structures. It's not going to change that much, because you cannot have CI done. You cannot integrate rapid enough to understand if it's going to work, yes or no. You cannot deploy fast enough to understand if this is now generating the expected outcomes, yes or no.
So you're talking about the second part of BDD. The first we discussed, so reducing the lead time with bringing the developers and the business people together. And this is the second part of DDD, so leaving documentation, so getting feedback that we are breaking something. And many times what I see is that when we try to automate, we delegate it to testers that are often manual, and we just say, oh, okay, we give you a pay rise, let's learn about test automation. But their mindset is still like a manual tester. So I did run these scenarios, now I rewrite it on Gherkin, and yeah, it's many times too late. And also many test tools disable the mindset that we can start from writing a test. Especially popular, I don't know if you know, are the tools that you say that the business guys can just click out the test cases. It disables us to write the test cases before the system exists. So yeah, many times testers start to write many scenarios. It's taking 2 years, and while they are doing this, the tests are getting out of date. So we only get a test suit with a lot of errors that everybody says, yeah, this is how it is.
Yeah, I also see that, I don't know why, but in many organizations where they have tests running and automated tests, either in SpecFlow, Serenity, Gherkin, whatever, so we also have lots of unit tests, for example, that they are not really stable. So meaning they didn't build the tests in according to for median good craftsmanship practices. So they don't build up the system, test, and then turn it, revert the changes and all that stuff. They rely on standard data in their tests, or having cyclic dependencies on each other. So for me, automated tests are equally important as the code you write for the feature. And if it's not, then your test suite becomes very unstable and then not trustworthy anymore. And then people will go to manual testing again and all the rest of the misery. So if I look at many organizations, I see many organizations working on the people kumbaya and on the structures, organizational structures. And then we need to have these 2 weekly iterations and split daily scrums. But they ignore this part of being able to go TDD-wise, BDD-wise, to be honest, whatever you want to call it, for me is to be able to have, from a technical perspective, then fast feedbacks. And technical perspective starts for me at the lower end, so with the unit test, being able to unit test, because in many organizations I enter these days, if you open up the code, you see it. You are not even able to unit test anything. So this is already a code smell, which will end up in lower performance of your application, which will end up with lower stability on your application, which will generate more issues and phone calls to your support desk and misunderstandings about users. So this is where, for me, the business benefit of an agile organizations really need this kind of stuff, because if you don't build it in, then the rest of the misery kicking in is going to be so tremendous that it's not even worth going through the pain of changing organization from a traditional phase gate to an agile organization. It's going to make it even worse. So for me, it's a driver to get into faster feedback cycles. And if you don't have fast feedback cycles, and this is for me still the main driver to go in technical excellence on refinement, bringing the people together and then really build it in a very good, sensible way, which is highly disciplined. And let's get back to, help me remind me to go get back to discipline, by the way. So, which is highly disciplined. Anyhow, let's continue on discipline. So I think this is the crucial factor why people don't, many organizations don't embody real technical excellence. Because of the high discipline. If you do trunk-based development and you have a good automated test suite, then you really do CI integrate continuously. So in the branch where it goes to production, by the way, so not somewhere in some kind of other branch where it sits there for another month. But if you really do turn-based development, it means as well, I need to check in every 1 hour. So I need to have the discipline to think about building, growing features and not build for 3 weeks in a row and then commit my code because now my feature already, no, I need to grow this feature now, which is a completely different mindset than we thought when we were teaching coding in school. We need to grow that feature now. And this is highly disciplined because every commit, every 1 hour we commit, things need to run. We cannot have broken anything else. We try to get the newly created tests green in that sense as fast as we can. Preferably, we do this in microcycles of 1 hour. So we write a small test within the same hour. We write a code. We clean it up. We commit the next microcycle. So this requires lots of discipline. It also creates discipline because if you do trunk-based development, then you really need to rely on your automated test suites, on all the rest of the checks that you build in, security checks, performance checks that you build in into your build pipelines. And then you really put blocking things. And I mean blocking on static code reviews like Sonar, for example. If it's not good enough, then you know what? The build stops here. You will never be able to put it in production. And this is more disciplined than many other organizations I have seen working. Because in many organizations, what do we see happening? They analyze for a long time, they build for a long time, they integrate suddenly, there's lots of defects, but the deadline of the deploy is there. And then it's like, people know it's full of defects and they say, let's go to production anyhow. If you really do CI and have technical excellence highly valued, then it is impossible to push it into production. Because your build pipeline just blocks it automatically. So you put the pressure on the people again to fix it rapidly. And this kind of high pressure discipline on how you code on a day-to-day basis, I think that's the reason many of the development teams just don't go into it or don't have the courage to go into it. Because at the beginning, it requires lots of effort. But once you get used to it, it's a lot of joy.
Exactly. This is what I want to highlight. So it has to be joyful. And we started with saying, why are developers hating Agile and so? And in the same example, I hate DevOps and CI because I hear many times about that. And yeah, I see operation teams call them DevOps. And I see feature branching approach called continuous integration, where exactly it's not continuous integration if you don't start with a test. It's not continuous integration if you can't verify your pushed build and if it's not blocked, if it's not failing. So yeah, the people are scared because they didn't work that way. And it's funny because I actually worked that way many years before in, I can say, Ericsson. And nowadays I see still operation departments with managers that are trying to reduce the operation department work, which is manually. And it's hard to shift. If the developers operate like we push it to the different departments, and if people in that manual department lose work, their job if the organization became agile. So yeah, you mentioned also trunk-based development. Maybe it would be nice to explain to our listeners what's different from feature branching.
That's a whole topic on its own. But in a nutshell, trunk-based development means you commit code to the branch, or actually the branch, the trunk where you will also deploy into production, generate your packages to deploy in production, and it immediately goes there. So if you do feature branches or any other kind of long-lived branches, if it's short-lived, then I don't bother. Yeah, short-lived, I mean 1 day, 2 days max, and that's it. That's okay. But if you have branches that live for a longer period in time, then you have work in isolation. And it's not only you, most probably somebody else is also having work in isolation. So we don't coordinate, we don't collaborate, we just work in isolation. And this kind of isolated work, when it hits each other, will probably have some effect on each other. And you don't know until it's too late. And then if it comes together, then this blame game comes into place as well, because we worked isolated, we don't know about each other, and it's like, you broke mine, I broke yours, blah, blah. So this is lots of misery, but there's a lot more on that. Anyhow, we need to close this recording down, Lose. So if we now say the importance of technical excellence for agile organizations, you need to point out to only three things that are highly crucial to within an agile organization and why technical excellence is important or anything else. So three takeaways for our audience on the subject we've been discussing.
So one takeaway is we can measure technical excellence in two dimensions. So reducing lead time by bringing developers and business people. And the second is to reduce this the feedback loop on is my code really working? This would be your first takeaway. Second takeaway, that it's all about competencies of the people that are building stuff. So they have to have the proper attitude and also skills. And many organizations invest in agile trainings about process and roles and don't invest into trainings that teach people to think differently. So think from formulating the business problem and then writing code, and also from thinking of, I firstly do this and then I write a test suite. And you have to see it on your own eyes before you do this. That would be my second takeaway. And my third takeaway would be about technical excellence. From our talk is, I would go back to say that it's the developer's responsibility, the people who build the product responsibility to think about that and do not shift it on the ticket system or on the product owner or client who wants features faster. They will always want features faster. It's your responsibility as a developer. And never ever did I hear that someone was fired because he did write good code. So that my three takeaways. What's yours?
Oh, that's good enough. So your three takeaways, so the two dimensions I like, then bring it all closer. Make sure you have faster feedback cycles on between, I think this might be useful, and it really is useful. So in production, then within the hands of the customer. So, and then mindset. So, and don't be a victim of the system. I love your takeaway. So thanks for the chat, Lose. And let's schedule another one sometime in the future and on some kind of more specific domain. Because today we went into lots of different directions, which is pretty normal. If we talk about technical excellence, people think it's for the techies. It's not for the techies only. Everybody should be interested in this thing. That's why it's crucial that we talk more about technical excellence. It's the language we use, the business language we use, is how we collaborate with each other between business and discovery and delivery, I would say, business and delivery organizations. It's about really the implementation at the bottom part as well. So it's the full shebang. So that's why it's important for any kind of organization. Anyhow, that's...
And it's really, really joyful to work in an organization that has technical excellence. So,
yeah. Cool. Okay, thanks. See you around. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.